Thank you, Eileen. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen. It's a privilege to be with you this evening. It's always a tremendous treat for me to come to South Africa. I love your country and I love your people, and I think you'll find that many Americans do likewise. I first came to South Africa in 1976. I came down to find out if South Africa was as bad as the American press and our American leaders was telling us that South Africa was. I traveled around your beautiful country for about 6 weeks. I fell in love with South Africa, and I went back to the United States, and after thinking about it a bit, I decided, well, you know, maybe South Africa needs some friends to tell its story, some Americans to tell its story. So I started a group which is now called the Council on Southern Africa, a nonprofit educational foundation designed to try to help Americans understand the strategic importance of South Africa and what's really happening in this country. Since that time, I've traveled out here probably about 25 times. I have been publishing an intelligence newsletter for the last 12 years dealing with Southern Africa, South Africa. I think many of you may have received copies as you came in this evening. If not, I would hope that you would get some before you leave. We bring groups of Americans out. I will bring my 12th group of Americans out this November, around 150 Americans. Okay, there is a purpose to my talk tonight, and the purpose is to communicate to you that as a country, South Africa is at war. It is a total war. You are every bit as much at war today as you were during the 1940s, except I believe it's a more intense war. It's a more total war. It's a war that is a psychological war, a military war, a guerrilla war, an economic, a financial war, and it is being waged by your enemies in the West, the political left in the West, as well as by the Soviet bloc. I'm convinced that South Africa will survive the war and prosper, but only if the South African people wake up to what is happening, understand that they are at war, understand who their enemies as well as their friends are, and learn the tactics and strategies of their enemies. And so this is one of the purposes of my talk around the country to the various military bases and groups of South African civilians in the last couple weeks has been to try to communicate some of these things. One of the things I will never do when I come to South Africa is to try to make opinions or give ideas on what you should do racially. I have no idea. I understand that there are problems here and there's a reform process taking place, and frankly, I think that Americans who come down and try to tell you what to do ought to look to their own situation. In America, we like to say that people in glass houses shouldn't throw rocks, and I think it's a big mistake for Americans, whether it's the Teddy Kennedys of the world, who are your enemies, or your friends, to try to come down and tell you exactly how you should make changes in this country. No one can do that better than South Africans of goodwill, South Africans of all races, black, white, colored, Indian, and so forth. Okay, we'll move along this evening. I'd like you to first understand a bit about who your friends are in America and who your enemies are. So I'd like to start out by giving you a bit of perspective on the U.S. political spectrum. In America, you have the conservatives. There are 1 to 2 million hardcore conservative activists. These people believe very strongly in the Constitution in America, in limited government, in free enterprise. They're very anti-communist, and they believe very much in traditional family values. They got President Reagan elected, but unfortunately are not well represented in the Reagan administration. You see, our presidents don't appoint as many people as you think. President Reagan only appointed about 6,000 people when he came to office, and there were only about 50 of those that were really hardcore conservatives, and today most of those are even gone. So we have a conservative president who has basically surrounded himself with liberals, and that's why there's not really been that great a change from the Reagan administration or the Carter administration before it, et cetera, et cetera. There's 20 to 40 million conservative-leaning people in America, and I think the number's closer to 40 million, and this includes the so-called Christian right. That would be 8 to 16, and I think it's closer to 16% of the American population, and certainly this is where you will find your friends in the United States in this conservative grouping. Now, the liberals have 1 to 2 million hardcore activists. They dominate, unfortunately, the media, the universities, the mainline religious denominations, the U.S. Congress, the judiciary, black civil rights groups, and many of America's largest financial organizations. They include groups like the Liberal Eastern Establishment, such as the Council on Foreign Relations, the Trilateral Commission. To give you an idea of the thinking of some of these powerful people behind the U.S. government, the Ford Foundation, which was the recipient of most of the Ford Motor Trust Funds, and which now distributes tens of millions of dollars each year to left-wing pro-communist activities all over the United States. The president of the Ford Foundation admitted in 1953, he said, All of us here at the policy-making level have had experience either in OSS, and that's the forerunner to the CIA, or other European Economic Administration, and our directives are that we use our grant-making power so to alter life in the United States that we can comfortably be merged with the Soviet Union. That was the president of the Ford Foundation back in 1953. There would be 10 to 20 million liberal-leaning Americans, 5 to 10% of the population. Now, in the middle is the great sleeping majority. This would be 180 to 210 million people, 75 to 85% of the U.S. population. They receive 97% of their information from the liberal U.S. media. 95% of that information regarding South Africa is so false and so distorted to have no relation to reality. All right, they understand very little about the world outside the U.S. If you ask the average American in this group to name you 7 countries in Africa, he could not do so. If you asked him to name 5 countries in Central America right next door to the United States, he could not do so. So unfortunately, these people, though essentially moral, they're not bad, they're just ill-informed. Some people would even say they're dumb. But this is the great mass, I wouldn't say it, of course, this is the great mass of the American people. And so if they don't even understand world geography, how can you teach them world geopolitics? A few years ago, they barely knew where South Africa is. So in summary, you have some friends and you have some enemies in America. The great majority of the American people are really not your friends or enemies, although you will find basically if you push them hard enough, they will tilt towards thinking that South Africans are okay. Now, the great majority of American blacks, unfortunately, are anti-South Africa. They have been politicized against South Africa. They have been told so many lies and propagandized and brainwashed so much about South Africa that they basically think the worst people in the world, probably worse than Nazis in Germany, are white South Africans. They have their leaders like Jesse Jackson and Coretta King and people like this who help propagandize them in order to build their own political power base among those blacks. The U.S. State Department, I would say, is clearly your enemy. The United States State Department is on record as believing the African National Congress is the legitimate voice of black South Africans. I will tell you today that the U.S. State Department is pushing for an ANC government in Pretoria. But if you want to go back in history a few years, you'll find that our State Department helped pull the rug on Chiang Kai-shek and place Mao Zedong in power back in the 40s. They pulled the rug on Batista and helped place Comrade Fidel Castro in power in the 50s. They pulled the rug on the Shah and on Somoza and helped place Khomeini and the Sandinistas in power in Iran and in Nicaragua in the 1970s. And today our State Department is pushing hard to overthrow the pro-Western governments of South Korea, of Chile, and of the Republic of South Africa. Their record is very, very poor indeed. As a matter of fact, the House Committee on Un-American Activities, which was our congressional watchdog committee over our internal security, it's been abolished long since by the liberals in America. But as early as 1960, they said, in a study they did on communist penetration of America, in their study they said that there were 1,000 known communists within the State Department. That was in 1960. I do not believe the situation has appreciably improved. It's probably gotten worse. The U.S. political left is your enemy, and that makes up a lot, but certainly not all, of the people in the Congress. You probably have a third of the people in the Congress that tend to be quite liberal, some who are absolutely radical. You have about a third who tend to be quite conservative, and in the middle you have a lot of congressmen that can barely spell their name or read. The media is really slanted to the left in America. That's about 95% to the left, and that is a major problem we deal with, not just on the South Africa issue, but on many other issues. In Hollywood, you have the Hollywood left, led by people such as Hanoi Jane Fonda and other Marxists in Hollywood. I was reading in your paper in Cape Town yesterday where the Hollywood left is now pushing to totally ban U.S. movies from coming to South Africa. That might not be all bad. We have some pretty bad movies coming out of Hollywood. There's 200 anti-apartheid groups directed by Moscow and the Communist Party USA. And finally, in America, you do have your friends who are the U.S. conservatives. Okay, now one of the things we want to do is we want to show you the big picture. I want to try to give you a perspective of the Soviet world onslaught, what their strategy is worldwide, then bring it down to what their strategy is in the continent of Africa, and then bring it down to what their strategy is directed against the Republic of South Africa. To do that, we'll start out with a map of the world. The red spots on the maps are where the bad guys are. bad guys would be the Russians and their friends, whether in Southeast Asia, whether in Eastern Europe, in the Middle East, in Africa, in the Caribbean Basin, Central America, and so forth. The Soviet Union believes that it can dominate planet Earth over the next 10 or 12 years. The Soviets have a very strong and tough leader under one Mikhail Gorbachev. Never forget that he was trained under the KGB leader Andropov. The Soviets are great chess players. The Soviets understand how to strategize and play decades in advance, and we in the West tend to usually react on a very short-term basis. They have a strategy, and they are working that strategy, and I'd like to describe to you some of the elements of the Soviet grand strategy. Now, the first element of that grand strategy is a disarmament campaign directed against the West in general and the United States in particular. The Soviets have seduced the United States into a whole series of disarmament treaties, starting with the Nuclear Test Ban Treaty of 1962, the Anti-Ballistic Missile Treaty of 1973, SALT I, SALT II, Détente, and now President Reagan is being misguided, I believe, into negotiations with the Soviets for still a new disarmament treaty, this time around to pull the cruise and Pershing missiles out of Western Europe. If we do so, in Western Europe, the Soviets already outnumber the United States and NATO conventional weaponry and manpower about 4-1, and that would leave Western Europe completely naked to a Soviet conventional attack over the next few years. If we pull those U.S. missiles out, I think you will find Western Europe sink very quickly into neutrality, and you will find NATO collapsing. So anyway, the Soviets are aiming a disarmament campaign at the West. They have a world peace movement. The world peace movement is really more than a peace movement. It's actually their movement for world revolution. It comes down through the Communist Party of the USA, on down through the KGB, and I think of interest to this discussion tonight, you'll see on this organizational chart where they come down to the South African Communist Party, the African National Congress, the United Democratic Front, the National Union of South Africa Students, the End Conscription Campaign, and yes, the South African Council of Churches, all an integral part of the Soviet world peace movement. Now, second is the Soviets sponsor national liberation movements all over the world. These are groups such as the Viet Cong in Vietnam, the New People's Army in the Philippines, the Irish Republican Army, the Palestine Liberation Organization, Montoneros and Tupameros in Latin America, the Sandinistas in Nicaragua, which went on to become the government of Nicaragua, the African National Congress, and SWAPO in Southern Africa. Number three is a propaganda war directed against the various target countries around the world. Soviets have tremendous resources in the world press, and they use those resources for various campaigns, whether it's an anti-Vietnam War campaign or whether it's trying to overthrow Chiang Kai-shek in the 40s or Batista in the 50s or the Somoza and the Shah in the 70s, or today they're using this against the targeted countries of South Korea, Chile, and the Republic of South Africa. Okay? Their next strategy is to pick off one pro-Western country at a time. They have picked off some 56 countries since 1917, 41 countries since 1945 when the Allies thought they won World War II. Since 1917, 36% of the world's population and 33% of the world's landmass has fallen under the control of the Soviet Union. Next, the International Terror Network. The Soviet Union is in charge of the International Terror Network. They coordinated and orchestrated through the KGB and their military intelligence, which is the GRU. They basically have a staff position, PLO, where the PLO helps orchestrate, train, and so forth. Six nation states involved in this international terror network: Libya, Syria, Iran, North Korea, Cuba, and Nicaragua. There are 110 known terrorist groups, 66 terrorist training bases in the Middle East. Libya has 18, Iran has 20, Syria has 12, Lebanon has 8 to 10. If you're really good, they send you on to terrorist finishing school in the Soviet Union, and then you will be redeployed either in the Middle East, you'll be redeployed back into Western Europe, perhaps into Southern Africa, or into North or South America. If that, then through Managua, Nicaragua, which is the Western Hemisphere headquarters for the Soviet terror network. Okay, if they go into North America, they go in through something called the Sanctuary Movement. This is an underground railroad, if you will, to induct terrorists in the United States through church organizations, through liberal church organizations in America. Okay, some of the better known of the terrorist groups around the Western world are Italy, the Red Brigades, Belgium, the combatant communist cells, West Germany, the Red Army faction of the Bader-Meinhof gang, in Spain, the Basque ETA, in Ireland, the Irish Republican Army, in France, direct action. We have a host of these groups in the Middle East, in Africa, North Africa, Abu Nadal, in South Africa, the African National Congress, et cetera, et cetera. These terrorist organizations, and there probably are, well, as I already said, there are in excess of 100 of them, they orchestrate and they coordinate and network very, very closely together. You will find them helping one another, so that you will find Shiite terrorists pulling off operations in Central America, and you may find IRA pulling off operations in Southern Africa, and so these people are beginning to move around. After all, they consider themselves to be members of a world army for world revolution. Okay? Here's a few of their leaders holding hands in Harare a year or so ago. Daniel Ortega, head of the Communist Sandinistas, Colonel Gaddafi, and Comrade Fidel Castro. You'll also find these people coordinating very closely the PLO, the ANC, and SWAPO. Okay? Now, here's a billboard that showed up in Belfast, Northern Ireland. At the top of the billboard, it says, West Belfast, apartheid-free zone. Okay, we aim to be free. The ANC, tell the world is it, freedom is at hand, the IRA. So you can see that these terrorist groups coordinate very closely. We had a great example of this in the last few weeks in the United States. We had a giant mobilization in the United States of left-wing groups. Nicaragua and Libya teamed up to give $3 million for nationwide demonstrations on April 25th. About 75 to 100,000 people marched on Washington. It was called the Mobilization for Peace and Justice in Central America and South Africa. About 50 groups participated, including the Communist Party USA, the U.S. Peace Council, and the African National Congress. Okay, we're looking at the elements of the Soviet grand strategy. Now let's look at the next one, which is the Soviets use surrogates. They use surrogates to overthrow the pro-Western governments or to maintain their communist regimes in power. The primary surrogates they use would be Cuba, would be Libya, North Korea, Bulgaria, and East Germany. The next element of the Soviet grand strategy is to dominate the naval or maritime choke points around the world. There's a number of these choke points along the strategic waterways and oil routes of the Western world. The Soviets would like to dominate those or the countries around them as much as possible. These include the Panama Canal, the Cape Horn, Straits of Gibraltar, the Cape of Good Hope, the Suez Canal, the Mozambique Channel, the exit from the Red Sea, Straits of Hormuz coming out of the Persian Gulf, where we've had so much trouble in the last few days. You remember the Exocet missile that the Iraqis launched against our frigate over there. Basically, the Straits of Malacca, Straits of Lombok, the Taiwan Strait. Soviets want to dominate the countries around these as much as possible. For example, you have in the Western Sahara today the Soviet-backed Polisario guerrillas who are trying to overthrow that government. And basically, if they should succeed, then they'll have a foothold right there on the Straits of Gibraltar. Okay. The eighth element of the Soviet grand strategy is to isolate the West from its mineral resources in the Middle East and Southern Africa. This is the so-called Brezhnev Doctrine, where President Brezhnev said in 1973, we will grab the oil from the Middle East, we'll grab the strategic minerals from Southern Africa, and then we will dictate the terms of surrender to the United States and to the West. The ninth element, gain control of Saudi Arabia and the Persian Gulf, neutralize Israel in something called Operation Pincer. Number 10, dominate South and Southern Africa. We'll talk about that. That'll be the major topic of our discussion this evening. Number 11, Soviet naval domination of the Indian and Atlantic Oceans, including the Caribbean. Number 12, neutralize NATO and the U.S. Western European allies. This is really progressing well. The Soviets are intimidating tremendously West Germany and the other countries in Western Europe with their tremendous superior conventional strength. How many countries backed the United States when we bombed Colonel Gaddafi last spring? How many European countries? Only one, England. Even though the United States keeps 300,000 troops in Western Europe and basically spends billions of dollars in protecting Western Europe, none of those countries would allow us to overfly their airspace. Okay, today you have a situation where Spain is talking about kicking us out of our four air bases there, making us pull our F-16s out. Again, if the United States pulls its missiles out of Western Europe now, the Soviets will simply move theirs behind the Urals and retarget them on Soviet Union or on Western Europe, but they'll be in a position to make a move on Europe in the next few years. I think NATO will collapse as a result. Next, conquest of Central America, revolution in Mexico, installation of pro-Soviet regimes from Colombia to the Rio Grande, and finally, nuclear blackmail. With the United States surrounded, outgunned, the Soviets come along and demand surrender or annihilation. Never forget, the primary target of the Soviet Union is my country, the United States of America. You are an intermediate target. You are a stepping stone, as is Central America, as is the Philippines, but we are the primary target, and unfortunately, most Americans have no idea that that is the case. Okay, the Soviets have a number of tactics for world revolution. Let's look at some of those tactics very quickly. First tactic is manipulation of the media. The Soviets are masters of manipulating the world media. They've penetrated the media in almost every single major country in the Western world. It's happened in America, it's happened in Western Europe, and it's happened right here in the Republic of South Africa. I will tell you that the communist press in America, as well as the liberal press, which are continually attacking South Africa and America, they don't even have to come up with their own fabricated stories. About half of the time, they simply copy anti-South Africa stories directly out of your South African press. And they even give them, they even quote that that's the source, and it makes it very difficult for Americans to defend you in the United States for your friends, because after all, how could the South African press, who's on the scene, be telling it wrong? Okay, next is infiltration of the universities and the major religions. Soviets have been doing this for 40 years around the Western world. Certainly they've done it in the United States. Certainly they're doing it right here in the Republic of South Africa. Okay, next is trade and financing by the West. Lenin understood that if the Soviet Revolution were to succeed, that it would succeed with financing from the West. And so he launched something called the New Economic Plan back in the middle 1920s. He went to the West and he said, look, we want to liberalize, we want to open up our economy, we want to basically become good guys, but we need help from the West. You need to give us your financing, you need to give us high technology, and of course the Western businessmen rushed in to do that, and they have never stopped doing that. Lenin also said at a point in history, he said, we will sell them the rope with which we will hang them. He said the greedy American businessmen or capitalist businessmen will rush in so greedy to make profits that they will help set up the scenario for their own suicide. Okay, to give you an example, back in 1972, then Secretary of Treasury, George Shultz, now our Secretary of State, helped negotiate the building of the Kama River truck factory in the Soviet Union. This truck factory was financed, designed, and built, and everything by the United States, government and large businesses. And you say, but really, what does it do? It cranks out over 200,000 Soviet military trucks a year, and it was made in America. As a matter of fact, this is an advertisement from Archer Daniels Midland, one of these powerful multinational corporations. It's a map of the United States and the Soviet Union. It says, this map is far from accurate, but does serve to illustrate a very important point. As trade between the USSR and the US expands, we're growing closer and closer together. And that's what the David Rockefellers and the Armand Hammers and some of our powerful finance capitalists really believe. I sometimes wonder if you don't have some people that think that way right here in the Republic of South Africa also. Now, this is what they were talking about, trade and financing by the West. Manipulation of liberals. My mind, every single country where the revolution has succeeded, the Soviets have managed to manipulate the various liberals, whether the liberal businessmen, liberals in the universities, in the churches, liberal politicians, et cetera, et cetera. Many of these liberals are very confused people and can't see the difference or can't see the real evil behind communism. Some of the goals of communism, the equality, all these things they seem to really like. They don't like their tactics or their ruthlessness, but you find these business people and these liberals often manipulated. This was the case in Nicaragua. It was liberals in America that were manipulated into supporting the sanctions against South Africa, and today there's a major effort to manipulate your liberal business people, university people, and so forth. You see them making the trek back and forth to Lusaka to begin a dialogue or negotiations with the ANC. Okay, the use of negotiations. The Soviets are masters at negotiating. They always negotiate for what is yours, not what is theirs. There's no sense in negotiating what is theirs. We in the West think that negotiations are the solution to everything. All right, but the Soviets have a totally different view. Negotiations are part of their tactical warfare. That's how the Soviet Union won, or the Communists won, in Vietnam. The United States military won the war in Vietnam, and yet it lost through the negotiation table. In fact, Henry Kissinger, our Secretary of State, was given the Nobel Peace Prize for negotiating a peace which ended up being a surrender and a total victory for the Soviets, but it was done through the negotiation process. Okay? Patient gradualism. The Soviets will move so gradually that we don't even notice. We never even noticed, most of us, them taking over some 56 countries, just one or two here and there. Next, infiltration and subversion. Soviets and their allies are masters at infiltrating the Western world. They've infiltrated almost every major government and country in the Western world, including your own. In the United States in 1945, we went to San Francisco and we sent a man who was an undersecretary of state out there to represent the United States in the formation of the United Nations. In so doing, he represented the United States to write the United Nations Charter. He became the first United Nations Undersecretary General for the Formation Committee. In that position, he set up 66 agencies. He staffed them with 500 of his own handpicked people. And it was only 3 years later that we found out that Undersecretary of State Alger Hiss had been a Soviet spy the entire time. Okay, whether it's our government, your military, the West has been infiltrated. Okay, next is the use of front organizations. The Soviets used non-communist front organizations in their revolutionary activities. They will often have non-communist liberals in them, but there's usually a few communists behind the scenes pulling the strings. We have dozens of these in America. Trans-Africa is a classic one. It kind of headed up the anti-South Africa movement, the sanctions movement, over the last couple of years. In the United States, in South Africa, you have the United Democratic Front. You have the End Conscription Campaign, and I will tell you, you have dozens of other communist front organizations. Okay, and finally, the use of the dialectic. Soviets will be marching forward, and they'll take a number of steps forward, and all of a sudden they'll turn around and they'll back up a couple of steps. And the people in the West are very confused indeed. And they say, my, maybe the Soviets, especially the liberals, they get very excited about these things. They say, maybe the Soviets really have changed their ways. Maybe they really are becoming the nice guys that we always knew they had the potential for becoming. And after all, look at Mikhail Gorbachev now. Mikhail Gorbachev is smiling at the West, why he dresses like an American businessman, why he is saying that he wants to improve the economy and the standard of living for his people, why he's even released 150 dissidents from jails. There's only 1.5 million left in the gulag. But it doesn't matter. The American liberals are elated. They say, we can negotiate with this man. We can have disarmament treaties with this man. We can send him more computers and high technology, et cetera, ad nauseum. This is the dialectic, and the communists use this so effectively against the West. These are some of their tactics for world revolution. Very quickly, let's run through some of the areas that we see the Soviets expanding in around the world today. First of all, let's look at what they're doing in the Pacific Basin. In the Pacific Basin, the Soviets have targeted the Philippines, where the United States has two large military bases, Subic Bay and Clark Field. These are our largest bases, ranging anywhere from the Persian Gulf to the far west, all the way to Hawaii to the far east. This is Subic Bay, an excellent naval facility. Soviets have in the Philippines their Liberation Army called the New People's Army, and the New People's Army, 20,000 strong, backed by the Soviet Union. The Soviets would like to exclude us from this area because through the region come the Straits of Malacca and the South China Sea, and these waterways have traveling over them about 50% of world trade, about 50%, I believe, of your exports actually travel across these, and the Soviets would like us out of there so they could dominate these waterways. They're very active in Cameron Bay, our old base that we built before we surrendered in Vietnam, and our naval and a naval base at Vladivostok. Operating out of these are some 600 Soviet warships, which travel the waters of the Pacific Basin. That's versus 300 warships for the United States. They outnumber us 3-1 today in the Pacific Basin, the lowest number of warships we've had in that region since 1945 at the end of the Great War. Soviets have a tremendous military buildup going on up in the Kamchatka Peninsula and also near the Sakhalin Islands and near Vladivostok. Okay, in time of war, the Soviets believe on a naval basis they could link these complexes between Petropavlovsk and Vietnam and also from Vladivostok. They've moved 355 bombers into the region, including 70 backfires equipped with supersonic cruise missiles. versus 12 U.S. bombers in the region. They have 1,820 fighters in the region versus about 920 for the U.S. Soviets are also very active down in the southern part of the Pacific. Here we find them having pushed in the last few years something called the South Pacific Forum. 18 nations have joined that Soviet-sponsored organization, including the Philippines and Australia and New Zealand. Nine have signed a non-nuclear treaty, agreeing not to let U.S. Naval power come in or U.S. air power come in. And you are finding now some 60 liberation groups, which are beginning to pop up out in the Pacific Basin. Just in the last couple of months, I think a month or so, Colonel Gaddafi took 300 people from these liberation groups and brought them to Libya for a terrorist training course. Gaddafi is very active in these countries in the Pacific Basin, Indonesia, the Solomons, Vanuatu, Kiribati, Fiji, Tonga, New Zealand, New Caledonia, and Papua New Guinea. So the Soviets are very, very active in the Pacific Basin. Okay? They have their game plan for Western Europe. Their game plan for Western Europe is basically to flank Western Europe from the north and south. The United States has positioned most of its 300,000 troops in Central Europe, mostly in Germany, and has always supposed and planned if there were a conventional attack that it would come across West Germany. Probably not. The Soviets have a massive military buildup going on now up in the Kola Peninsula, the largest military buildup anywhere in the world. They have about 400 warplanes, about 400 naval vessels, 150 surface vessels, about 150 submarines, 12 divisions, including two motorized divisions, and right across this Norwegian border is a grand total of 500 border guards. Okay, Norway will not allow NATO troops to be stationed on their soil, and if the Soviets decide to make move on Europe, they will probably have this flanking motion, drive through those border guards and straight down the Norwegian Peninsula in about 48 hours, and would attack Western Europe from the north. Their game plan would also be a flanking movement to the south, whereby they would pour out of Russia through the Middle East, perhaps over Turkey. They have a warplane plan for taking Turkey. They do not believe that NATO or the Western powers would come to the aid of Turkey any more than we did the aid of Afghanistan. They would come down through the Middle East, North Africa, out of southern Russia, and the southern end of the pincer would attack from the south. Now, they may not attack Western Europe, they may not have to, but certainly they can intimidate Western Europe with their tremendous military strength. Okay? They also have, as I mentioned, 150 submarines near the Kola Peninsula, another 40 to 50 here in the Baltic. These regularly traverse the Atlantic and come to the southern end of the terminus, which is Cuba and Nicaragua. One must remember that in 1942, German U-boats, German submarines, actually sunk in the North Atlantic in 1942, 1,006 U.S. and Allied merchant vessels. In time of war, the Soviet submarines would blockade this Atlantic and basically try to prevent U.S. shipping from getting over to reinforce our friends over in Western Europe and or even in Africa. Let's look at what the Soviets are doing to the south of the United States in my own region, which is down in Central America. They came to take over Nicaragua in 1979. The Sandinistas were placed in power by the Carter State Department, which teamed up with the Russians and Cubans, even though the Sandinistas had clearly been born, bred, financed, and trained in Havana, Cuba. Since that time, a massive military buildup has taken place in Nicaragua. Today, there are 36 military bases in that country, 20 air bases, 20,000 Soviet bloc troops, an army of 200,000 in a country of only 2.2 million. Last year, the Soviets moved in 25,000 tons of military equipment. You say, how much is that? It would be the equivalent of 2,500 MiG-23s, only it's not MiG-23s. It's helicopter gunships, it's tanks, it's armored cars, it's the conventional weaponry with which they believe they can conquer Costa Rica, Panama, Honduras, El Salvador, Guatemala, Belize, and even Mexico over the next 3 to 6 years. Soviets believe they can dominate this whole region over the next few years. They will probably wait until President Reagan leaves office. They remember that we did take out a communist base in Grenada, and so they'll probably wait for a year or so, but they have big, big plans for this region. Okay? Now, oh, by the way, before I leave this region, I should point out that Soviet bombers, Tupolev and Bear bombers, now fly out of military bases in Managua all the way up the west coast of the United States as far as Washington State and back. As well as for years, they've flown out of Cuba, near or across the tip of Florida, and up the eastern seaboard of the United States, as far as Maine and back, without refueling. And in both instances, anytime they want to, they can be loaded with nuclear weapons. Soviet strategy for our Caribbean basin is basically a triangular air-sea domination of the basin, ranging from Cuba to Nicaragua, linking up with Guyana and Suriname. They had Grenada in the complex, and back in 1983, due to some of the really good advisors in the Reagan administration, who unfortunately have been pushed out by the State Department in the last couple of years, we did go in and we took Grenada out of the loop. Okay, they were building a large air base in that country. Today, massive Soviet military buildup in Guyana and Suriname, very active in this region. It's vital to the United States. 50 to 60% of our trade in oil come through this region, through the Panama Canal and the various waterways of the Caribbean Basin. In 1942, 8 German submarines actually came into the Caribbean Basin, and in 8 months they sank 263 U.S. and Allied merchant vessels. Okay, the Soviets believe that they can dominate Mexico in the next few years. Soviets have a giant fifth column operating in Mexico. Mexico was the base of operations from which they conquered Cuba, going back a long way, 1958. In fact, if you think the Soviets aren't the chess players of the world and aren't long-term strategists, remember this. Back in 1920, the Soviet Union had a meeting in Baku, Russia, and they issued something called the Manifesto of Baku. And it was a long-term blueprint for the conquest of the Western Hemisphere, and they said, we will establish a stepping stone in the Western Hemisphere, and we will do so in the middle 1950s, and that stepping stone will be Cuba, and they did so in 1958. They did so, unfortunately, with help from their friends in the State Department, and also from the U.S. media, which portrayed Fidel Castro as a great agrarian reformer. After all, they said he was the George Washington of Latin America, the Robin Hood of the Sierra Maestra, et cetera, et cetera. But they did it from base camps in Mexico. Today, the Soviets have a huge fifth column operating in Mexico. Just as you have seen the communist flag openly flying in the last few years in some of your black townships in South Africa, you will see it flying in certain areas down in southern Mexico, where the Mexican government tolerates communist base camps operating against the pro-Western government of Guatemala. There are about 900 KGB agents operate out of the Soviet embassy. Today, the Mexican president, De La Madrid, his country is closer to Cuba and Russia politically than it is to the United States. De La Madrid refers to comrade Fidel Castro as my comandante. Isn't that a warm, friendly term? They have their bloc committees, communist bloc committees, again, not too unlike some of the committees that you've had in South African townships in recent years. The Soviets use this as a base of espionage against the United States. They move billions of dollars a year of drugs into the United States, partly to demoralize the United States and also partly to raise money for the various terrorist organizations in this part of the world. Last year, 1.5 million illegals were caught coming across this border from Brownsville to Tijuana, a 2,100-mile border. They were caught and sent back. Another 4 to 5 million illegals got through. Today, that's right, they got through. And our authorities know that terrorists are coming in with those, and then they're being scattered across the United States through the sanctuary movement. If the dominoes, or when the dominoes, begin to fall in Central America over the next few years, there are 100 million people living in this region, and there will be a thundering herd of 20 to 25 million that will have only one direction to go, and that will be straight north. By the time about 10 or 12 million of them have come pouring into the western United States, there will be a wholesale panic in the United States. The people will demand that the government will do something, and the only thing it will be able to do is pull the army out of Western Europe. And if NATO has not already collapsed by that point, it will at that point. And so this is the kind of chess game, long-term chess game, the Soviets are playing. Remember, they're surrounding us just like they're surrounding South Africa today. In the Middle East, the Soviets have a game plan which is called Operation Pincer, a long-term surrounding the Persian Gulf oil field as per the Brezhnev Doctrine going back to 1973. Okay? 18 terrorist training bases in Libya, but the most important aspect of Libya is that the Soviets are using this as a giant arms storage depot, and they're pre-positioning massive amounts of arms in Libya, much as they are in South Yemen, Western Afghanistan, and in Syria, for future operations in the Middle East, for future operations in North Africa, operations against Southern Europe, and for operations against the Republic of South Africa down in Southern Africa. Some of these arms are definitely being transshipped down to the frontline states right now, and this idea of the Soviets of pre-positioning arms and then bringing in pilots and so forth to fly them later is something you're going to have to watch in the countries to the north. The game plan is to come down through Chad, through Sudan, through Ethiopia. They had northern Chad, and actually they had a bit of a setback in the last month and a half. Northern Chad was overrun by the Army of France and Chad, and they overran a number of these Gaddafi bases, killed 3,500 of Gaddafi's troops, and so that was a bit of a setback, but don't worry, Gaddafi will be back. Okay, there's a pro-Gaddafi government in the Sudan. There also is one in down in Uganda. Total Soviet surrogate in Ethiopia. They took over in 1974. They later murdered Haile Selassie. And this pincer is designed to put pressure on Egypt, to push Egypt back into the Soviet camp from whence Sadat brought it back in 1972. Mubarak's military officers are pushing him more and more to go back towards the Soviets. New agreements are being signed between Egypt and the Soviet Union, and so this pincer movement pressuring Egypt is certainly working. Right-hand side of the pincer comes down through Afghanistan. It's designed to come into Iran and into the Saudi Arabian Peninsula. Soviets moved into Afghanistan in late 79 and early 1980. Today they have 120,000 troops in Afghanistan. They have killed 1.5 million men, women, and children in Afghanistan since about 1980 or 81. And you would think that this would mean that in the United States, people would be out demonstrating in front of the Soviet embassy in Washington, but they're not. They're all out demonstrating in front of the South African embassy, because we all know that South Africa's public enemy number one, certainly not the Soviet Union. Okay, now, the Soviets do believe in disarmament. The Soviets have a little different form of disarmament than most of us would suppose. Here is one of their weapons of disarmament. Looks like a doll, doesn't it? It's not. It's a bomb. They drop these from airplanes along with other kinds of toys by the tens of thousands. And the little Afghan children pick them up and they blow their arms off and they blow their hands off and they blow up in their faces. And they're designed not to kill but to maim. So the tens of thousands of these children will be the wards of the Afghan rebels, and it'll slow them down in their battle against the Soviets. Soviets have built 8 major military bases in Afghanistan, 4 more under construction. They basically are trying to split off this part of Pakistan, this part of Afghanistan, and this part of Balochistan into the Independent People's Republic of Balochistan. A lot of American liberals say, oh, isn't it wonderful? Afghanistan is the Soviets' Vietnam. It is not the Soviets' Vietnam. Vietnam was not next door to the United States. Afghanistan is next door to the Soviet Union. We had an anti-war movement to totally demoralize our war effort. And by the way, you have one developing via the End Conscription Campaign in South Africa. But the Soviets, of course, would never tolerate an anti-war movement. They would shoot those people. We had CBS television and our media to totally undermine our war effort, and I believe you have a bit of the same in this country via some of your print media, et cetera, et cetera. Soviets wouldn't tolerate that. But what they are doing in Afghanistan is they're using it as a training ground for their military. They're rotating their troops through. Every 6 months, they rotate a fresh batch of troops through, and so they have trained about 1 million in combat training, about 1 million of their army in Afghanistan. They're also testing new weapons in Afghanistan and kind of ironing out some of the wrinkles in their military equipment. Okay? The game plan is to eventually drive on down into Iran. The Soviets today have 23 or 24 divisions along this Russian border with Iran. If Khomeini dies, not if, but when he dies, the Soviets plan to invade Iran. They think Khomeini can't live forever. I'm not so sure. It seems like he's such a nasty man. Maybe he'll live for another 100 years. Who knows? At any rate, Khomeini was a KGB agent for probably 15 years. He had close KGB connections, which then makes it rather strange that the Carter administration pulled the rug on the Shah of Iran and helped place Khomeini in power. He's a very valuable tool right now to the Soviets because he helps orchestrate this international terror network. He trains thousands of these Shiites, and you need to understand that these Shiites are now cooperating with your terrorists in southern Africa. The car bomb that went off today, I believe it was a car bomb that killed 3 policemen right here in Johannesburg. Don't think that the African National Congress learned those kinds of techniques on their own. They're learning them from the Shiites and the other terrorists in this part of the world and also up in the Soviet Union. Now, we all have only one ally in that part of the world, and that is the Israelis. Okay? Now, tremendous efforts on the part of the U.S. State Department to sever the relationship between Israel and South Africa. And I certainly hope your country will take steps to make sure that that does not happen. Israel basically got tired of the PLO running terror attacks on them, and in the summer of 1982, they launched an invasion into southern Lebanon to take out the PLO base camps. They were surprised to find enough arms to arm an army of about 150,000, even though the PLO only had around 12,000 troops. They also found an underground infrastructure where Russian military officers were coming in from submarines. They found intelligence that indicated that the Soviets were planning some kind of a move on the Middle East, probably in the spring of 1983. They found intelligence documents closely linking the PLO with the African National Congress, and they kept on marching to the north. The Israelis marched on north, and they bottled up the PLO in West Beirut, and they were going to wipe out the PLO like the mad dogs that they are. But guess who intervened to save the PLO? The Reagan State Department. George Shultz and, of course, the State Department are very pro-PLO. Okay, and they said, but you can't do this. This would be a very unfriendly thing to wipe out the PLO. So they sent in 1,800 Marines to rescue the PLO, and they deposited them in about 8 different directions like so many AIDS germs, and then took our Marines and placed them at the airport in the low spot where no military man would ever place them, and they were quickly surrounded by tens of thousands of hostile Shiites, Druzes, et cetera, et cetera. And finally, a suicide bomber, a teenager from Iran, a Shiite teenager trained in a truck bombing factory over in Syria, broke through with a truck bomb and blew up the barracks, killing 241 Marines. A very sad day for America. Now, the reason that the Marine sentry didn't shoot the truck bomber was because his gun was empty on orders from George Shultz, our Secretary of State, who said, after all, if it's a peacekeeping force, how can you keep the peace if there's ammunition in your gun? Okay? That shows you the kind of mentality of our State Department. Okay? The United States got very demoralized after that. We pulled our troops out and sailed them away, and today the Soviets and the Syrians, along with the Iranians to a lesser extent, now dominate Lebanon, along with a host of these Shiite crazies. Okay, we've looked at the Soviet global strategy. Now let's look at an overview of the Soviet strategy in Africa. Okay, first of all, the Soviets mean to dominate the African coastline, and I think maybe this map of Africa will be useful to examine for a few minutes. Now, most Americans, and perhaps some of you South Africans, will be surprised to see that many countries in Africa are already dominated by the communists, by the Soviets or their various surrogates. I think that's quite a few. Okay, Morocco is one of their targets, the starred countries, including Chad, Sudan, Zaire, Namibia, Malawi, and of course, the number one target is the Republic of South Africa. Soviets want to dominate the coastlines of South Africa for some fairly obvious reasons. One is that eventually they want to be able to stop the oil shipments around the Cape. But even as important, they want to deny port facilities to the United States Navy. The United States Navy has nowhere to put in from Mombasa, Kenya, all the way around to Nigeria, 4,000 or 5,000 miles. We could use Simonstown and Walvis Bay. It's been offered by the South African government, but our politicians say no. South Africans are bloody racist and will have no part of it. I don't think our Navy feels that way, by the way, or our Defense Force, but certainly our politicians do, and our State Department does. And so we are denied port facilities and naval facilities for around 5,000 miles. Not so for the Soviets. For the Soviets, they have naval and port facilities in the Maldives, Ethiopia, Tanzania, Zanzibar, Mozambique, the Seychelles, Madagascar, Angola, the Congo, Guinea-Bissau, Sierra Leone, Upper Volta, and the Cape Verde Islands off the Western Horn of Africa. In fact, the Soviets are now establishing a submarine base in the Cape Verde Islands. Next time you fly to Europe through Ile de Sol, peek out the window and see if you can spot any construction activity. You probably can't, but it's going on. Okay, they're also building some kind of submarine operation over in the Seychelles, which should really be a little further off of our map. Okay, so the first then strategy is to dominate the African coastline. Second is in North Africa to dominate the Horn, to establish the Greater Libyan Empire, and to implement something called Operation Pincer. Okay, Operation Pincer, we already discussed, the long-term surrounding of the Persian Gulf oil fields as per the Brezhnev Doctrine. The Horn of Africa they came to dominate when they took over Ethiopia in 1974, and they've promised Colonel Gaddafi, if he plays ball with them, that they will make him the emperor of all of North Africa. And they're trying to use Gaddafi to take over as many of these countries in West Africa as they can. You already have a pro-Gaddafi government in Uganda, and their game plan for Central Africa is to basically take Zaire, which is very rich in cobalt, diamonds, copper, and so forth. Okay, there's now 4,000 North Koreans in Angola, and perhaps those will be used along with the Katangi's Liberation Forces to try to take out Zaire in the next couple of years. Let's move on down. Let's look at the Soviet strategy for Southern Africa in the frontline states. Okay, first let's look at Mozambique. In Mozambique, the troop strength is approximately about 25,000 Frelimo troops, about 15,000 Zimbabwean troops now operating in Mozambique, and those are fairly well trained compared to most other black African troops. They had a lot of experience during the war over the last few years. 5,000 Tanzanian troops and about 10,000 East Bloc advisors. Now, you must understand the U.S. State Department loves the communist government of Mozambique. They think that they're the greatest thing since sliced bread. And recently, Chester Crocker, the head of the African desk of the State Department, said to the U.S. Congress, he said, "We do not consider the government of Mozambique to be, in the sense that you use the term, a communist government." In the last 6 years, the State Department has pushed $78 million in direct aid to communist Mozambique and $154 million in multilateral aid. The Soviets, in the meantime, have provided $1 billion in military aid to Mozambique, and it's kind of like the United States State Department has gotten together with the Soviets, and they've decided, okay, you Soviets provide the military aid, and we Americans will provide the economic aid, and that's exactly the way it is working. Okay? Now, the government, our Crocker also said to our Congress a couple months ago, he said, the government of Mozambique has been working systematically in the past 4 or 5 years to move away from its previously close embrace with Moscow. If Mr. Crocker were not so pro-Moscow, he would not say silly, silly things like that, because it's simply not true. In March, delegations from the Soviet Union, East Germany, and North Korea were in Mozambique, simultaneously negotiating new economic and military agreements with Frelimo. We received in Washington recently unconfirmed reports that 2 battalions of Cuban combat troops have arrived in Beira, with another 5 expected shortly. Russian, East German, and North Korean military assistance has been stepped up sharply since Chissano came to power, as have Soviet arms deliveries. Recently, the State Department sent Michael Armancost, who is the number 3 man in the State Department. They sent him out to Africa, and the first place he went was to Lusaka, where he visited with the ANC, and he came back and made this brilliant pronouncement that the ANC really should be the legitimate voice of blacks in South Africa. And then he traveled over to see the people in Zaire and see Hastings Banda in Malawi, and he demanded of those 2 governments that they cut off any aid and assistance bases, what have you, for RENAMO, the anti-communist Mozambique resistance movement. And we understand that this, in fact, has happened, and you've had some major military setbacks in the last few months, or last few weeks, as a matter of fact, for RENAMO, but we blame that partly on the fact that the U.S. State Department is trying to cut off aid for RENAMO. When I was in Cape Town with a group of Americans in March of 86, we asked the ambassador from the United States, we said, why do you think that the Mozambique is really coming our way? And the ambassador, State Department man, he said, why, it's obvious that they're coming our way. They're willing to take American money. Well, gosh, the Russians and the Red Chinese take our money. I'm not sure that means they're coming our way. At any rate, the U.S. State Department, through the auspices of Chester Crocker, has sponsored membership for Mozambique in the International Monetary Fund, arranged a $45 million IMF loan, and has pushed the U.S. Congress for $1 million in military aid to Samora Machel and now to the government of Chissano. Your friends in the U.S. Congress blocked that military aid, and so the State Department went to England, to Margaret Thatcher, and they pressured her, and today England, through the British SAS, is now training communist military officers, Mozambique military officers. Some of them are being trained right there in Sandhurst because of pressure from the U.S. government. Okay, now let's look at Zimbabwe. What a beautiful country that used to be when it was called Rhodesia. Robert Mugabe is now the political leader of the frontline states. He went to Moscow in 1986 to raise funds for Mozambique and for an army to be composed of all the frontline states as well as Ethiopia. Mugabe has taken over the war in Mozambique. He has pledged, quote, eternal friendship to Gorbachev. Mugabe is just in the process of spending $324 million to buy 12 of these. This is a MiG-29 Fulcrum. This is the most advanced Soviet warplane in their arsenal. It is amazing to me and your friends in America that the Soviets are now escalating the kinds of sophisticated equipment that they are delivering to the frontline states. Mugabe's broke, of course. He can't afford to pay for it. He will barter all kinds of farm crops, et cetera, et cetera. But it shows the kind of escalation that's taking place in weapon systems coming into the frontline states. They'll send in hundreds of technicians to help support those planes. I've had people tell me, well, don't worry, they probably don't have pilots that can adequately fly those planes. Let me tell you, it takes no trick at all to fly in Russian pilots, Cubans, East Germans, Bulgarians, North Koreans. In fact, communist pilots from India are now being flown in to fly MiGs in the frontline states. In addition to these coming in next year, they'll be delivered next year, there'll be 10 troop-carrying helicopters, which carry 16 troops apiece, and Zimbabwe is about to start buying Javelin missiles from the British government. Okay, so much for Zimbabwe. Let's hop on over to Angola. Your friends in America are also concerned about the Soviet military buildup that's taking place in Angola. In Angola today, you have about 45,000 Cuban troops and advisors. You have about 2,500 Soviets, about 2,500 East Germans, around 4,000 North Koreans. We are deeply concerned about the North Koreans that are coming into southern Africa. What in the world are North Koreans doing down here? They are down here to fight against the resistance movements first and against the Republic of South Africa second. Don't kid yourself, the North Koreans are tough. We fought them in Korea. Those are very, very tough troops. You better watch out for them. Soviets have moved $4 billion of war material into Angola, $4 billion in the last few years, $1 billion last year alone. Okay, the Soviets basically would like to launch another major offensive against Savimbi. A few months ago, a month or so ago, we understood it was coming, although Crocker is now actively negotiating with the Soviets and the communist government of the MPLA to try to get them to say something positive about pulling out Cuban troops. The State Department is pushing very actively today to get the United States government to recognize and restore diplomatic relations with communist Angola. I don't think that will happen. Your friends in the U.S. Congress are actively opposing a lot of these things on the part of the State Department. Okay, the Soviets are sending a lot of sophisticated equipment in to this part of the world. This is the Mi-24 Hindi helicopter gunship. It's one of the most vicious weapons in the Soviet arsenal. There's about 36 of these down in Nicaragua. They use them in Afghanistan to wipe out whole villages, and they certainly are bringing more and more of these into the frontline states. I understand that a number of these have been shot down by Savimbi using our Stinger missiles. Soviets also have the most concentrated air defense system outside of the immediate Soviet bloc in Western, in Eastern Europe, right around free or liberated Angola. Tremendous number of anti-aircraft missiles, radar, et cetera, which is going to make it tougher and tougher for the South African Air Force to fly in the defense of Savimbi, et cetera, et cetera. You can see kind of the buildup that's going on. It's accelerating with 7,000 Cuban troops in 1975, 12,000 Cuban troops in 1978, 30,000 by 1982, and about 45,000 by 1986. Just a month or so ago, the leaders of Angola were talking about substituting all those Cubans with North Koreans, which wouldn't be much fun. I think they've since decided not to do that, but nevertheless, the North Koreans are coming in more and more. Okay, this is the kind of sophisticated equipment I think you can see. This you're going to see in southern Africa in the next year or so. This is the newest helicopter gunship that the Soviets have just developed. Okay, their game plan is to try to overrun Savimbi, and I don't believe that your military will allow that to happen. But if they were to do so, then they would come moving very quickly down into Southwest Africa and Botswana. Let's talk about South Africa now. Thank you, Eileen. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen. Let's talk about South Africa now. We've looked at the global strategy and the African strategy. Now let's look at South Africa. South Africa is the most strategic country in the entire world as far as the United States and the West is concerned. 90% of the strategic minerals of the entire world are controlled by South Africa and the Soviet Union. Okay? Brezhnev knew what he was talking about when he said, let's grab those minerals. For example, platinum, 99% controlled by Russia and South Africa. Manganese, 92%. Chromium, 90%. Vanadium, 80%. Gold, 75%. Fluorspar, 50%. A U.S. government report has indicated that if South Africa were to fall to the Soviets, then basically the U.S. Air Force would be grounded in 6 to 12 months. Much of our industry would start closing down. Of our key heavy industry would start closing down without these strategic metals within 12 to 24 months. So Brezhnev knew what he was talking about. In addition, around the Cape shipping lanes come 90% of Western Europe's oil, about 40% of our oil, in supertankers, which are too large to go through the Suez Canal. Soviets dominate southern Africa. They would not only cut those shipping lanes, they would quickly come to dominate the Indian Ocean. Soviet publication, The African Communist, published in East Germany, said in 1984, quote, the balance of forces not merely in southern Africa, but in the whole of Africa, and indeed the world, would be fundamentally altered if the South African Revolution were to succeed in its aim to overthrow the apartheid state. Okay, let's look at the grand strategy to dominate South Africa that the Soviets have. First is external encirclement. Second is economic warfare against South Africa. Third is internal demoralization and psychological warfare. Fourth is internal revolution and all of the above leading to negotiations and piecemeal surrender to the revolution. This is the strategy of the Soviets. First is encirclement. Just as you saw on the map earlier, they are encircling the United States to the south. They are doing the same thing. They are encircling you to the north. Let's look again at the frontline states. From 1977 to 1986, the troop strength in the frontline states rose 135%, from 150,000 to 357,000 troops. That includes 45 to 50,000 Cuban troops, around 20,000 East Germans, North Koreans, North Vietnamese, Russians, Bulgarians, etc., etc. In that same 10-year period, the tank strength of the various frontline states increased 320% to 1,600 tanks. Their air power increased 170% to 900 warplanes, including about 400 high-performance jets, fighter aircraft, et cetera, et cetera. We already mentioned the 12 MiG-29s, the sophisticated jet in the Soviet arsenal coming into Zimbabwe next year. Zambia, $180 million of Soviet military buildup in the last couple of years. In Mozambique, $1 billion worth. Now, what concerns your friends in America is that yesterday, the South African Defense Force is the dominant military power in this part of the world. But in the next 3 or 4 or 5 years, if the Soviets keep moving more and more arms, equipment, and men, Soviet bloc troops into that part of the world, you may find that the South African Defense Force is no longer the dominant military force, that the combined forces of the Soviet bloc are the dominant military force. And we have great respect for your defense force and certainly for Arms Corps. But let me tell you something, Arms Corps can't build weapons as fast as the Soviet Union can, and they can ship them down very quickly, and as I already said, they're beginning to ship weapons out of their arms storage depots in Libya, et cetera, et cetera. At some point, you've got to halt this military buildup that's taking place to the north. Okay, that's the basic encirclement that the Soviets talk about to put external pressure on South Africa. Next is economic warfare against South Africa. This is called sanctions. Soviets concluded that sanctions needed to be employed against South Africa to do a couple things. First, the American liberals are real dumb. They thought if sanctions were pushed through, that this would bring South Africa to its knees and that basically apartheid would evaporate overnight. We tried to tell them that's not really the way things work in the world. People don't like to be intimidated into making changes. And if anything, the rate of racial reform, which has been going on in South Africa the last few years, will slow down if sanctions are passed. But the liberals are not very bright in America, and they didn't listen to that. The Soviets are not totally dumb, though. They viewed sanctions as a way to put tens or hundreds of thousands of blacks out of work, and then to be able to push them into so much poverty that they could be radicalized by the UDF and the ANC and the revolutionaries, and then brought into the revolution as cannon fodder for the revolution. So the Soviets had somewhat a different plan in mind for the sanctions. Okay, now the sanctions didn't start in America. They started in the Soviet Union in 1981 in the Politburo in the Kremlin, where Boris Ponomarev, the chief Soviet strategist, sent a directive to all the members of the Soviet Internationale, instructing them to initiate a campaign in their countries to isolate and to undermine the Pretoria government. A few weeks later, in October of 1981, the Central Committee of the U.S. Communist Party in the United States issued a plan for the installation of the African National Congress as the government of South Africa. October 9 to 11, 1981, a meeting was called at the Riverside Church in New York City, the Conference on Solidarity with the Liberation Struggles of the Peoples of South Africa. It was co-sponsored by the American Communist Party, by the ANC, and by SWAPO. The conference called for comprehensive sanctions against South Africa, reinforcement of the mandatory arms embargo, increased support for ANC and SWAPO, increased support for the frontline states. Attending that meeting were some of the leaders of the Communist Party. Angela Davis was there. You had Reverend Jesse Jackson, who was running for President of the United States. He was there. Ron Dellums, the black Marxist congressman from California, who helped author the sanctions bill for the Congress side last year. He was there. A lot of congressmen and senators, et cetera, et cetera. This is where the sanctions movement began. It was born at the Riverside Church, which is a beehive, if you will, of pro-communist activity in New York City. It began to grow behind the scenes. They began to build an infrastructure, and most people didn't know this was going on. We tried to warn your government, and I think they probably knew it was coming. Basically, it broke out into the open in the fall of 1986. It's appeared to be spontaneous. 84, I'm sorry. It appeared to be spontaneous. It was not. Then we began to hear about the Free South Africa movement, which was headed up by TransAfrica, which is a Soviet-backed communist front, headed by one Randall Robinson. We began to see demonstrations in front of the South African embassy in Washington. Randall Robinson is pictured here in the middle. Here with him are the Kennedy children, and to his right is Senator Gary Hart, the man who until 2 weeks ago, when he was deposed because of a sex scandal in America, isn't that a shame? The man who is the leading candidate to become the next president of the United States. Here, this leading candidate for the United States presidency was out demonstrating with the communists in front of the embassy in Washington. And so they got a lot of senators and congressmen and people from Hollywood, et cetera, to come out and join in this. And this built up a lot of momentum. And finally, in mid-1986, or in the fall of 1986, the sanctions bill was passed. Okay, the sanctions bill basically does the following. It bans the U.S. importation of South African iron, steel, coal, uranium, textiles, farm products, Krugerrands, banned South African Airways landing rights in the United States. Now, about the time we pushed South African Airways out of the United States, we allowed Aeroflot, the Soviet airline, to come back in. It had been pushed out by Jimmy Carter, and sometimes I think Jimmy Carter, as bad as he was, is going to look tough compared to Reagan by the time Reagan leaves office because of what Reagan's State Department is doing. But we pushed South African Airways out because we said, you are horrible violators of human rights, and we let Aeroflot come back in because obviously they are not violators of human rights, or are they? Okay, that's the kind of hypocrisy and selective morality which rules amongst our liberal left in America today. Ban the South African importation of U.S. arms, computers, and bank loans. I understand computers are still coming through. I think those were banned primarily to parastatal-type organizations here in the country, of which there are quite a few. Number three, it demanded the release of all political prisoners, what they call political prisoners, ANC, SACP terrorists, including Nelson Mandela. Put pressure on U.S. allies such as Israel, Taiwan, Chile, Japan, to cut all military relations with South Africa or to lose U.S. aid. Okay, it demanded the unbanning of the ANC, the PAC, and the Black Consciousness Movement. And this is the most important part of the sanctions bill missed by most South Africans. It demanded negotiations to turn over power to these groups. This is what was really behind the sanctions bill. It was not to simply end apartheid. It was basically to establish an ANC government in Pretoria. Okay, you could see this in reading the fine print of the sanctions bill. You could look at the addendums and so forth and the amendments that the Bidens and the people like the Kennedys and so forth added. Okay, Senator Jesse Helms is one of your great friends in the U.S. Senate. He has stood up for South Africa so many times, it's incredible. He is the ranking Republican on the House Foreign Relations Committee, and he said the following during this big battle. He said, quote, "The intent of the new legislation is to recognize the communist movement of South Africa as the legitimate and preferred successor to the present government of South Africa. The bill itself gives preference in almost every respect only to those opponents of the government and those groups that are deeply committed to the Communist Party of South Africa, an organization funded and controlled by the Soviet Union. The non-communist leaders of the blacks and the non-whites are treated as if they do not exist." Okay? This is the sanctions bill. That was Jesse Helms. Number six includes U.S. government funding of millions to the revolutionary groups. I'm sorry to say that the U.S. government is basically funding about 160 different revolutionary pro-ANC, pro-South African Communist Party groups in this country, and your government has got to find a way to cut that funding. Okay, number eight, it orders the president to push for similar sanctions to be imposed by other Western nations and by the United Nations. Okay, so point number two of the Soviet grand strategy to dominate South Africa, economic warfare against South Africa, try to isolate and weaken South Africa economically, try to put hundreds of thousands of blacks out of work, et cetera, et cetera. I believe it's going to backfire. I think it's going to backfire for the following reason. I think they miscalculated back in the early 70s when they put an arms embargo against South Africa, and they caused South Africa to go out and basically build arms corps. It is now the ninth largest arms manufacturer in the world, and you have become more or less self-sufficient in arms. And I think that South Africa will become even more self-sufficient than you already are in a lot of different areas. So if you can make very quick adjustments, I'm not sure that there's not at least some positives. I know there's some negatives, but some positives that will come out of the sanctions. Number three, internal demoralization, psychological warfare. The people of South Africa are the target of the most concentrated psychological warfare directed against the people in modern history. Hitler said, tell a lie, tell it often enough, and the people will believe it. Lenin said the highest art of war is not to fight at all, but to subvert your enemies by destroying his moral principles, his religion, his culture, his whole tradition. When a country is demoralized, you can take it without firing a shot. Sun Tzu, the Chinese military strategist, said in 500 BC, to defeat a people, you must first demoralize them and destroy their will to resist. And this is what's happening through a tremendous propaganda barrage against this country, both from within the country, a lot of it through your own media, a lot of different publications, and from outside of the country. Warfare is 80% psychological and 20% military. I fear sometimes that your government is fighting at about 90 to 95% on a military basis, and that's fine, but only about 5 or 10% on a psychological warfare basis, and that's not fine. Okay, now, the purpose of the psychological warfare is to isolate South Africa. I don't mean just to isolate South Africa sanctions-wise. You're already isolated geographically. To isolate you in your minds, to isolate the psyche of South Africans, to make the South African people feel that you are unwanted, unloved, that you stand alone, that you are among the very worst people in the world. And this is done in so many ways. I remember back in 1977 or 1978, there was a pro-Soviet organization in the United States, and its primary function was to go around the world and push sports boycotts, okay, to isolate the South African people. And they said in some of their literature to their own people, they said, look, South Africans are fanatical sportsmen. They love their sports. They love to compete. They love to compete internationally. And if we can isolate them with respect to sports, it will demoralize them. It will pull their morale down. It will really hurt them psychologically. It's not spontaneous. I mean, this has been planned and orchestrated. Okay, you're not in the World Olympics, which is incredible. Soviet Union is, South Africa is not. Some justice. I read in the paper today where they're trying to exclude you from the World Badminton Association. I didn't even know there was a World Badminton Association. And they said, well, it's a victory. You've only been suspended and you haven't been totally kicked out. But no matter what it is, whether it's the World Red Cross, cultural organizations, to psychologically isolate South Africans, to create a national guilt complex against South Africans, particularly white South Africans, make you feel like you are the worst people that ever lived, that you have treated blacks worse than anyone in history. Let me tell you who's treated blacks worse than you South Africans have. We Americans have. In America, we brought them over in slave ships. I hope that doesn't mean you approve of the way we've treated our blacks. We kept them in balls and chains for 100 years. We only de-discriminated against our blacks around 30 years ago. And even that is a bit of a facade. Today, if you go into the major cities of America, you will find that there's 20 to 25% black unemployment, whereas the government says overall unemployment is only about 7%. We have some ghettos that, in my opinion, make Soweto look like a very nice place. Okay, but you're the worst people in the world, certainly not the Americans. What about the blacks to the north? Look how the blacks to the north have treated other blacks and the massive millions of blacks that have been killed by other blacks. Look at how blacks and whites are treated in the communist countries. But don't think about those things. Just remember that you're the worst people in the world. A national guilt trip is being put on South Africans. It's being done by your media. It's being done by some of your liberal politicians. It's being done by your liberal university professors, even some of your liberal business people, et cetera, et cetera. It is part of the psychological warfare to demoralize South Africans. Preach defeatism and appeasement. You can't win. You don't have a chance. America is against you. The political left all over the world is against you. Black Africa is against you. The United Nations is against you. The Soviet Union is against you. You don't have a chance. It's inevitable. The ANC has eventually come to power, going to come to power. You might as well go to Lusaka and negotiate the best peace possible with them. And that's what some of your liberal businessmen and religious leaders and university people are doing right now. Myopia. Get South Africans to see their problems only in racial terms and not in the larger context of the East-West struggle. The vehicles of psychological warfare in this country are the media, both the global media and the South African media. And I've already mentioned that your friends in America are very, very concerned about the South African media. There's a lot of brainwashing of the South African people that are going on. I'd like to show you a publication. I don't know if you've ever seen this, but it's a very slick magazine called Leadership Magazine. Okay, it's financed by one of the largest corporations in South Africa. Inside this magazine, it says Leadership Magazine is published every 2 months as a vehicle for top-level debate. Written by leaders in various fields, it is aimed at those people most likely to influence events in Southern Africa. The cover article, and this is just a few pages of the magazine, they send this to business leaders all over South Africa. They send it to business leaders. I got a copy of it in the United States. The cover article is all about Robert Mugabe. It's actually an article by Frederick von Sales Slobbert. Let me tell you something. I think you are all misled. Robert Mugabe is a fine man. He is a wonderful man. He's not a communist. He's not a Marxist. He doesn't work with the North Koreans. I mean, that's just a fabrication. Robert Mugabe is a wonderful man. If you don't believe so, read this article. It is pure, unadulterated propaganda, and it is directed at your business leadership in South Africa. And I read, as this magazine comes into my office, I read the other articles, and it's very subtle. I mean, it's not gross. It's very subtle type propaganda. It's very slick and it's very sophisticated, and it's part of the psychological war. And there's a lot of other publications like this that are being directed against various groups, religious groups, university groups, et cetera, et cetera. Okay, the universities are another one of the vehicles of psychological warfare. Preach defeatism, preach radicalism through the students and so forth. And this is done in the United States, all over the Western world, but it's also done right here in South Africa. The leftist religious movement in this country, the South African Council of Churches is in the leadership of that. 99% of its financing comes from outside of South Africa. Okay, and they push something called liberation theology to undermine the Christian faith in this country, and we'll come back and touch on that in a minute. Another vehicle for the psychological war is the anti-war peace movement. So much like our anti-Vietnam War movement in America, the so-called End Conscription Campaign. Okay, these are all elements of the psychological warfare, which is one of the major phases of the Soviet grand strategy to dominate South Africa. Next is internal revolution. There are a number of elements to the internal revolution. First is the sanctions or the economic war. We've already talked about that. It's designed to hurt the black people, to radicalize the black people, and to weaken South Africa as a whole. Next is terrorism, guerrilla warfare, and township violence. Okay? They can't have a revolution without killing people. That's basic. You've never seen a revolution in the world that you basically didn't see violence, and this revolution is no different. We begin to see this in a lot of the black townships in South Africa over the last couple of years. We begin to see the Soviet flag very, very openly flying. We begin to see large mass demonstrations. We begin to see at those demonstrations some necklacings, killings, violence, et cetera, et cetera, all designed to intimidate the moderate black South African, the businessman, the moderate black policeman, the mayor, the town councilor, whatever, into going along with the revolution. Don't support reform. Don't talk to the people in the government. Go along with the revolution. Okay, part of that violence has been the murder of moderate blacks. As you know, many, many hundreds of moderate blacks have been violently murdered by the revolutionaries. This is town councilor Kenny Kenny's son. He and his five sons were butchered by the revolutionaries. This is Maki Skosana. She was a 24-year-old black girl. She was pregnant. She was accused of being a government informer. She was kicked, she was beaten, she was thrown on the ground. Stones were thrown on her, gasoline was thrown on her, and she was burned to death. Before the UDF revolutionaries burned her to death, however, they called in a news team. They wanted to make sure that they got pictures of this poor girl's death. That was their mistake. Americans, even American liberals, even blacks who have said there's nothing good about South Africa, et cetera, et cetera, the ANC is great and everything else in South Africa is bad, have begun to rethink their position after they have seen the murder of this poor girl. So we're getting a lot of publicity on that in the United States. The necklace treatment. As many of you know, the necklace treatment has been used again to intimidate the blacks in South Africa. Who knows how many? 200, 300, 400, 500 blacks have been necklaced, and I guess a few whites. This is also receiving widespread coverage in the United States. As a matter of fact, in the United States, when people think of the ANC, they're beginning to think of the necklace treatment. Okay, so I think it's backfiring on the revolutionaries. Okay, now one of the leading spokesmen for and allies of the ANC and the liberation groups in this country is one Winnie Mandela.
We have stones, we have boxes of matches. With our necklaces, we shall liberate this country.
Let me tell you something. There are people in America talking about giving a Nobel Peace Prize to Winnie Mandela. I just saw a picture in the paper the other day of the big house she's building. I got to tell you something. I should come down and do what she does. She's got a bigger house than I do. She's probably got a bigger house than half of you in this. It's under construction, but it'll be a big house. It pays well to be a comrade and to be a traitor to your country. Car bombings. You're also going to see more and more of this terrorism and guerrilla warfare directed against the whites. As you know, just in the last 24 hours, there was a limpet mine went off in the Carlton Center downstairs, and I guess sometime today there was a car bomb that went off here. In fact, I understand there was two bombs, and they kind of set up the police so that the police would come out, and three policemen were killed by the revolutionaries. I would hope that that would make South Africans appropriately cross, as you like to say. These revolutionaries are backed by the Soviet Union, by the UDF, by the ANC, and I don't care what political party you are, I don't care whether you're black or white. When you see these communist butchers doing that to your own people, whether black or white, I would think that it would make you very, very cross indeed. Those sophisticated bombing techniques, as I said earlier, they're learning from the terrorists in the Middle East and from the Soviets. They're always bombing devices and so forth that come from the Soviet Union. This is the car bomb that took place in Pretoria out front of the Air Force headquarters a couple of years ago. Okay, so terrorism, guerrilla warfare, township violence, one of the elements of the Soviet-backed revolution in South Africa. Next is infiltration of the churches, something called liberation theology. Lenin said a few years ago, he said, we shall find our most fertile field for the infiltration of Marxism within the field of religion, because religious people are the most gullible and will believe almost anything as long as it is clothed in religious language. Basically, the Soviets couldn't figure out why they weren't having success in Latin America a few years ago. The Soviets were very, very puzzled about this. And they said, gee, we're doing everything. I mean, they even lost Che Guevara. He got killed down in Bolivia. And they spent millions and millions, and the revolution didn't take off because they were going head-to-head with the Catholic Church, okay? And they finally decided, hey, we can't beat them, we'll join them. And so they went back to the drawing boards in the Soviet Union, and they came back with something called liberation theology, okay? And liberation theology, the essence of liberation theology is that Jesus Christ was the original revolutionary. He was killed for his support of the oppressed masses of his day. And never fear, he will be resurrected as a communist guerrilla with AK-47 in hand. Now, this liberation theology is sweeping Latin America. It's sweeping Nicaragua. It's the main reason the communists came to power in Nicaragua. They were able to harness the energy of the Catholic Church and Protestant denominations to support the revolution in their country, but they're doing it in Nicaragua, they're doing it in the Philippines, and they're doing it in South Africa today. Let me read you the essence of liberation theology. They say, Marxism is the only solution for the world. Revolution and the kingdom of heaven are the same thing. A Christian should embrace Marxism if he wants to be with God and men. Liberation theology identifies sin with unjust social structures, especially capitalism. Salvation or deliverance from sin is achieved by armed revolution. The Vanguard Party acts as the Messiah, leading people to the true kingdom, which is socialism. Jesus, as it is claimed, sided with the poor. So Christians must side with them politically, fighting against their oppressors. As God became incarnate in the flesh, so Christians must become incarnate in the Marxist revolution. Jesus is reinterpreted as the first revolutionary, a zealot engaged in political liberation of Israel from the Roman rule. Liberation theology teaches that Jesus was a rebel, a revolutionary, and an opponent of the capitalist system. It teaches that Jesus was the God of the poor, not of the rich, that he died as a political agitator to free the oppressed from the unjust rule, that those who suffer under such rule are continuing the sufferings of Christ, that God's will is for Christians to engage in the struggle to liberate the oppressed. I must assure you, ladies and gentlemen, and I'm a Christian, that that is not the gospel of Jesus Christ, that is not the gospel of the Bible, that is a satanic Soviet perversion of the gospel of Jesus Christ in order to suck unsuspecting Christians into the revolution, and it is spreading like a prairie fire through your white churches as well as your black churches of South Africa. To be a complete Christian, one has to be committed to the revolution, such commitment being the real criteria for distinguishing real Christians from non-Christians. Whoever fails to make this commitment is not only an enemy of the people, but an enemy of Christ as well. Who are the leaders of your liberation theology in this country? The South African Council of Churches, Archbishop Desmond Tutu, Dr. Alan Busack, Dr. Byers Naudé, and the Catholic Archbishop Dennis Hurley. There are many, many more. It is very subtle. It is very dangerous. And since the Soviets started employing this in Central America and Latin America, they are winning victory after victory after victory. Okay, let me show you very quickly a couple of leaders of liberation theology. Here's Dr. Alan Busack, one of the UDF's leaders, preaching for the overthrow of the government of South Africa, and behind him is the Soviet flag. Alan Busack came to the United States a couple of months ago and was going to speak at the California State Legislature. And we decided, gee, we'd try to help the guy out. You know, he needs help. He's traveled all that far. And so we decided we'd give him a little advanced publicity. So we handed this picture out to every member of the California State Legislature. And guess what? They disinvited him to speak. Too bad. Okay, here's some of your religious leaders marching at a funeral in front of the Soviet flag. Here's a few more of your religious leaders, black and white religious leaders, again marching under the banner of the Soviet Union. Here's one more of your religious leaders, Dr. Alan Busack. Again, he's in the United States. He's in the home of Jane Fonda. We call her Hanoi Jane Fonda because of the support that she gave to the North Vietnamese during our war in Vietnam. And there he is in the home of Jane Fonda in Beverly Hills, California. Look at the smile on his face. It looks like he just swallowed a canary, doesn't it? Wouldn't you like to know what they're talking about? I suspect she was giving him consolation because I think that might have been the day that they didn't let him speak at the California State Legislature in Sacramento. Okay? So this is infiltration of the churches. Liberation theology is one of the key elements in the Soviet grand strategy or revolution in South Africa. Next is infiltration of the universities. Certainly this is happening in the University of the Witwatersrand. This is happening in the University of Cape Town, the University of the Western Cape. There's even a tremendous amount of radical activity that is now showing up at the University of Stellenbosch. This is not just here, it's in every single major country in the free world. And they use university students. The university students were key to the conquest of Cuba back during the Cuban Revolution. I mean, Comrade Fidel, this is where he became a communist, was at the University of Havana. Okay, so infiltration of the university is one of the elements. Domination of the media, we've already talked about that. the people's education, push a parallel educational system, particularly in the black townships. Who needs reading, writing, and arithmetic? Let's get into the real heavy-duty stuff. Let's talk about liberation, what it's going to be like in the new liberated South Africa, et cetera, et cetera. People's education. They push as one of the elements the end conscription campaign. The end conscription campaign is a very subtle form of psychological warfare directed against the South African public to get them not to support the South African Defense Force. And ladies and gentlemen, without the South African Defense Force, you will become a communist government and the Soviet flag will fly in Pretoria. So you keep in mind, you better keep your South African Defense Force strong. This is an anti-war movement, very much like our anti-war movement in the United States, to try to tell the people in America during the Vietnam War that this was an unjust war. And they got help in America. The Communist Front organizations got help from the media and from CBS television and so forth. And there was a tremendous demoralization of the American people. And because they demoralized the American people, we did not have the moral will to win the war in Vietnam, which militarily we could have won. Okay, the End Conscription Campaign has two major international connections, the London-based War Resisters International and the War Resisters International U.S. affiliate, which is the War Resisters League. Both are part of the Soviet International Peace Network and fall under the umbrella of the World Peace Council. They both coordinate closely with the Communist Party of the USA and with the Weather Underground, the IRA, the PLO, the Biter-Meinhof Gang, et cetera, et cetera. In turn, the End Conscription Campaign works very, very closely with the War Resisters League in America. Okay, they operate out of the War Resisters League offices in America. If you'd like to see where they are, here's some of the different locations around the United States. And intelligence authorities in the United States understand that the End Conscription Campaign, like our anti-war movement, like the War Resisters League, is part of the Soviet-dominated world peace movement. A very prominent member of the ANC, speaking on radio, Freedom, being from Addis Ababa, said the following a couple of months back about South Africa's military services. He said, "Those whites who find themselves conscripted must do everything possible to weaken this military machine. And it can be weakened in numerous ways. It can be weakened by a huge campaign within the white community, within the whole of South Africa, black and white together. But obviously the white community must play a very important role, a campaign against conscription, a campaign against service in this war machine." He then expounded at length on how every effort must be made to turn members of the SADF into quislings, to traitors, to the army, to their country, and to their civilization, exactly as Marxist members of the Portuguese army sold out their own cause in Africa in the early 70s. He went on to say, "Those whites who find themselves within, those who want to belong to the side of liberation must do everything possible from within to weaken this army, and they can do so by organizing themselves within the SADF. They must agitate from within. They must find the means to organize themselves within that organization, just as happened in Portugal when they were fighting their war against Mozambique, Angola, Guinea-Bissau, et cetera, et cetera. The End Conscription Campaign is a very, very dangerous element of the Soviet-backed revolution in this country. It must be exposed for what it is, and it must be stamped out. It is not here to do any good." Next, infiltration of the unions. The Soviets and the communists have infiltrated around 30, or have come to dominate, I should say, around 30 out of around 200 labor unions in South Africa. Never forget that some of the most successful communist revolutions in the world took place through the labor unions, and through the labor unions they were finally able to escalate things to a general strike, and that's what they're going to try to do through your labor unions. Incredibly, your labor unions are getting a lot of support from the United States government, the State Department, the Labor Department, the Commerce Department, the AFL-CIO is pouring a lot of financial aid into your radical pro-communist labor unions, and that needs to be stopped. The ninth element of the Soviet-backed revolution is seduction of the business community. Soviets, the communists, the ANC, the Cubans believe that that is a very, very important element in the revolution. I was visiting with this Cuban defector in Washington 2 months ago, and we were talking about the ANC strategy for 1987 and beyond, and he said one of the key things that they are trying to do is get liberal businessmen to come to Lusaka to negotiate with them, get liberal businessmen to push for a new dispensation, because they were so successful in getting liberal businessmen as well as liberal religious leaders in Nicaragua, they basically pushed the revolution over the top, and they're trying to get this, a number of your liberal businessmen in this country to do so. And so I find it very, very disturbing when I find some of these people making the trek up to Lusaka. Let me tell you what they do with these business people. Among other things, they promise them that they will get special dispensations. They will get special concessions. It's called monopoly powers when they finally take over. And they use kind of the carrot stick technique. If you work with us, if you cooperate with us for a new dispensation, for a coalition government, for our new government of national reconciliation, as they like to call it, you will have a great future in South Africa. But if you don't, you will have no future. And so basically, that's the way they buy off business people. And they're doing this in the Philippines today, and they're doing it in South Africa. Those are the nine elements of the Soviet-backed revolution. It's a two-phase revolution. The first phase deals with the National Liberation Revolution, which basically is to establish a national democratic government, a coalition between communists and non-communists. In all their writings, the South African Communist Party, the ANC, and the communists say, hey, in countries like South Africa and other third world countries, they say, you can't go directly from a non-communist government, like the present one, to a communist government, so you have to do it on a phased basis. You do it on a stepping stone basis. Okay, and the first stepping stone is a coalition government. So you get the liberal business people and religious people and university people, and you get them to come to Lusaka or wherever, and to negotiate for a coalition government, a government of national reconciliation, et cetera, et cetera. And once that's installed, the West says, oh my, a victory for democracy has really taken place, and they quickly start moving towards phase two. A people's democracy or communist state is established. The liberal democratic elements are purged out. It's exactly how they did it, a two-stage revolution in Vietnam, Cuba. Nicaragua is the clearest example you have, and it's in the Philippines in process right now. They've already gone through the first stage. Very quickly, let's look at the ANC strategy for 1987. It includes expansion of murder, sabotage, and arson to the white residential areas and urban centers. Expansion of murder, arson, and intimidation of the white farms, mining of the farm roads. Expansion of the role of the UDF, the United Democratic Front. Terrorist attacks against the citizens of the national homelands and the independent states. Programs and propaganda to cause divisions among the whites. It's called divide and conquer. And I must tell you that the Cubans and the Soviets and the ANC are incredibly disappointed over the elections that took place a week or two ago in this country, because they were hoping that you would see a tremendous division and a tremendous lack of support for your government, and apparently it didn't go that way. Okay, in October of last year, the ANC issued a document calling for the following strategy towards the whites. They said, an important element in our strategy is winning over to our side or neutralizing as many white people as possible. As the general crisis, the apartheid system deepens as a result of the intensifying struggle, so does it become more possible for us to make further advances in our work among the whites. Our success in work among the enemy armed forces will obviously be greatly enhanced by the political advances we make among the white population in general. Number six, the ANC strategy for 1987 involves progressive federal party youth groups and the end conscription campaign in a broad democratic front. I didn't say it, the ANC said it. Number seven, encourage more dialogue between South African businessmen and the ANC in Lusaka. That keeps popping up more and more and more. Number eight, increase the use of neighboring states as springboards for terrorist attacks in the Republic of South Africa. Number nine, moderate the ANC image internationally, play down the connections with the South African Communist Party. And finally, isolate the South African government within South Africa as it has been isolated internationally. Make the South African government to appear inept. Make them to appear as if they were really irrelevant. That's a little tougher now with the elections that took place in the last week or so, but that basically is the Soviets' game plan. Okay, anti-South, and by the way, don't think that the ANC hatches any ideas on its own. The ANC gets its strategy from the South African Communist Party, from the Cubans, and from the Soviet Union. Okay, the anti-South Africa strategy of the U.S. left for 1987, cut off aid to UNITA and Angola. They are desperate. They really want to cut off aid to UNITA to try to get Savimbi out of the picture. Next is to push for $700 million in aid to the communist frontline states. The liberals in America, they are such incredible idiots. Liberals in America say, gee, they're suffering in the frontline states because of the sanctions which we Americans imposed, and therefore it is our obligation to come in and alleviate that suffering. And so they're coming in with my taxpayers' money, that's partly my money, the $700 million, and I don't like it, to aid the communist frontline states. Among other things, they're going to use a bunch of that money to try to rebuild the Beira Corridor. Now, they're very concerned about the buyer quarter because they reckon that the fur-lined states are dependent on the rail line that comes down through South Africa, and they don't like to see that, and so they want to see the buyer quarter open back up, and they're willing to use hundreds and hundreds of millions of dollars of U.S. taxpayer money to do so. Okay? Next is the passage of new sanctions legislation. A new sanctions legislation has been introduced, and it's been sponsored by Senator Cranston and Ron Dellums, both leftist politicians from California. Major effort to improve the image of the ANC in the U.S. Okay, this is a magazine cover from the African Communists, fourth quarter 1986, the Journal of the South African Communist Party. It's printed in East Germany. Okay, at the bottom it says, ANC, SACP, unity is unbreakable. I'll just bet that it is. Oliver Tambo was recently in the United States as a guest of the United States State Department. The United States State Department brought him over to try to give him some international credibility. Okay, we thought that was very, very disappointing. By the way, here he is on the front page of the African Communist. Long live the ANC, South African Communist Party Alliance. I think there can be no doubt as to where the ANC really stands. Well, he came to the States, and the State Department was going to try to raise his profile and help his image and reputation and that of the ANC. And so we decided that we would try to do our part to help. After all, man's traveled that far. You've got to show him some hospitality. You've got to try to help him with public relations. So we organized demonstrations out in front of the White House, out in front of the State Department. We bussed in a couple of truckloads or a couple of busloads of black students. These were conservative Christian students from over in Kentucky. We got a truckload of tires, and we put the tires around these fellows' necks. We assured them, no gasoline, no matches. Winnie wouldn't have enjoyed it. It wouldn't have been any fun, no matches. But at any rate, we called in the national press, and we said, let us tell you about Oliver Tambo. Let us tell you about the necklace treatment in South Africa. Let us tell you about the connections with the South African Communist Party. And we did so, and we got a lot of national coverage. And, you know, I think raising the image of the African National Congress, as the State Department was trying to do, didn't do quite as well as they had hoped. We got some congressmen and senators, some conservative congressmen and senators to come out and describe what the ANC really was and so forth. So I think it rather backfired for the State Department. The State Department was hoping that Tambo would say really friendly things about how he was for brotherhood and a new dispensation and a government of national reconciliation and all this, but being a bit of a revolutionary, he really didn't do that. Here's what he did say at Georgetown University to a student audience. He said, quote, we have no alternative but to intensify our armed resistance. When our forces triumph, they will redistribute South Africa's white wealth. I believe that belongs to some of you out there. Confiscation of white property is necessary to raise the impoverished standard of living for millions of our people, end quote, Oliver Tambo. Okay, so he came to the United States, and we're doing our best to let the American people know who and what Oliver Tambo and the ANC really are. Number five, increased U.S. pressure for total severing of Israel relations with South Africa. The political left in America foams over this connection between South Africa and Israel. They just go bananas over that, and I hope they're not able to totally scuttle that. Okay, number six, increased U.S. government aid to the black revolutionary groups in South Africa. It's coming to 160 different organizations in this country, and your government needs to find a way to stop it. And number seven, the State Department is pressuring Americans not to travel to South Africa. In January of this year, a fellow from South African Airways, who helps us with our groups that we bring out here, he came into my office, and he was furious, and he threw down this magazine on the table, and he said, I want you to see this, and I thought he was going to blow a gasket. And he said, and he showed me, and there was a memo that had been put out by the State Department to all of our travel agencies all over the United States, telling them that it was unsafe for Americans to travel in South Africa, and that if they traveled in South Africa, they might be arrested by the South African government, especially if they were caught carrying a camera, et cetera, et cetera. What incredible propaganda from the United States State Department. But this basically is the strategy of the anti-South Africa left for 1987. Okay, now let's talk about a few things that we believe, your friends in America believe, that South Africa should be doing. Okay, the first thing that we would like to see South Africa do is recognize, both your government and your people, recognize that you are at war. You are at as much war as you were in 1945, but it is a far more dangerous war because you have powerful forces from the West as well as from the East that are trying to overthrow your country. It is a political war, a propaganda war. It is a psychological war. It's a military and a guerrilla warfare war. If you think it's not war, did any of you catch the television tonight about the bombing here in this country, right here in the city of Johannesburg today? Ladies and gentlemen, that's war. You need to recognize your enemies. The political left in America, as well as the Soviet bloc, the frontline states, and the United Nations. You need to think, act, and behave as if your country is at war. And here's some of the other things you need to do. Number two, maintain the state of emergency. We feel very strongly about that. Number three, we recommend you do not release Mandela or the other ANC terrorists or negotiate with the ANC revolutionaries. You will get tremendous pressure from the political left in America to do just exactly that. Don't do it. I visited in Washington about 2 months ago with a Cuban defector. He was very high up in the Soviet, or in the Cuban foreign ministry. Okay, and he spent many, many years out in Africa working for Cuba and working for the Soviet Union. His name is Juan Benamelas. He basically had worked in the early 1960s with Che Guevara, as Che Guevara was going around for Russia and for Cuba and setting up, helping to organize the revolutionary movements of Africa. He said that he met three times along with Che Guevara, with Nelson Mandela and with Oliver Tambo. They met in Ghana, they met in Algeria, they met in Libya. He said he was personally responsible for handing over massive amounts of weapons to Nelson Mandela, which included 48,000 Soviet-made anti-personnel mines, 210,000 hand grenades, etc., etc. Now, Nelson Mandela is a man that the United States State Department and the people from the political left in America believe ought to be, excuse me, the next prime minister or state president of South Africa. I know that may sound ridiculous to you, but I mean, this is the way the political left in America thinks. Number four, the psychological war needs to be combated. We think that a lot needs to be done in the area of the psychological war. We think that South Africa is losing the psychological war badly at this point among its own people, black, white, colored, and Indian. Okay, we would like to see an educational campaign on the nature and strategies of the revolution, U.S. government duplicity, liberation theology, the end conscription campaign, etc. We think SABC TV should be fully utilized in this counter-Psy war campaign. The state president should hold regular fireside chats on SABC TV to appraise South Africans on the revolution. Blacks, coloreds, Indians, and whites all need this education. You need to be going into the black townships of this country, and you need to be giving training on anti-communism to the blacks in this country. They're South Africans. You need the blacks, you need the whites, you need the coloreds and Indians to all stand together against this onslaught, but you've got to understand it if you're going to fight it, okay? Number five, we think the South African government funding to the leftist universities should be cut until they clean up their act. Number six, U.S. State Department and other personnel should be kept on a short leash and expelled if caught aiding the revolutionaries either overtly or covertly. Let me tell you something that happens all the time. I will tell you that the State Department personnel are collaborating with the UDF, the ANC, the various revolutionary forces in this country. They've done so for years. People from the information service and so forth. Now, if you have American personnel down here and they're doing their own thing and they're keeping their nose clean, that's fine. But if they're participating in the effort to overthrow your government, it should be stopped. Let me give you an example. Back in about 1977 or 78, the ambassador, the U.S. ambassador to South Africa, his plane was used as a spy plane to spy on Rhodesian military installations. It was photographing them, and it was passing the information back to the Communist Patriotic Front. That man should have been expelled from South Africa. In fact, he should have been made to swim back to the United States. If he made it, he would have better man for the effort. I suspect he might not have made it. If they stir up trouble, if they work with the revolutionaries, put them on a short leash or kick them out. Number seven, U.S. government funding to the revolutionaries and the liberation groups should be cut. Our government is funding, it's part of the sanctions plan, it's part of something the State Department has been doing for years, and you need to find where that funding is coming from, and there's a whole bunch of organizations it's coming from, and a whole bunch of organizations it's coming to, and your government knows who they are, and they need to find a way to cut that funding. And I was very pleased to hear the state president say this in his speech in the parliament yesterday. In fact, the state president has said a number of these things, which makes us feel very, very good. Number eight, all foreign funding of the South African Council of Churches, the UDF, labor unions, and revolutionary groups need to be cut. Number nine, counter sanctions against America and other Western powers and black African states who are boycotting South Africa should be phased in. You've got strategic minerals. Use it as a weapon. Use your strategic minerals as a weapon. Number 10, the foreign press should be kept on a short leash, as should the pro-revolutionary elements of the South African press. Why should foreign newsmen coming into this country, or your own domestic newsmen, be able to do things that propagandize, help in the psychological war, give aid and comfort to the revolutionaries, which will ultimately destroy all your freedoms, including the freedom of the press? Okay, and I'm pleased to see your government is taking some steps in that direction. Number 11, your friends in America feel very strongly about this. And by the way, a lot of these things are kind of a composite of ideas from a lot of your friends in the U.S. Senate, the Congress, various organizations around America, and also in the U.S. military, which, by the way, the military in America is not your enemy. The State Department may be, but the military is certainly not. South Africa's borders need to be secured. The communist governments of Angola, Zimbabwe, and Mozambique should be overthrown, either covertly or overtly, and the anti-communist resistance movements in those countries strongly supported. We believe you need to avoid making the mistakes that we made in Vietnam. In Vietnam, America was the stronger power. Obviously, we could have won that war in 2 weeks. Our politicians kept us from doing so. In Vietnam, we sought negotiations instead of victory, and we dissipated the advantages of superior force by their incremental and gradual application. This was our McNamara strategy for defeat. Today, South Africa is stronger vis-a-vis the frontline states than you may ever be again. I understand you've got a great defense force, you've got arms corps, et cetera, et cetera. You can't build arms as fast as the Soviet Union can, and they can ship them down here in a real big hurry. So your friends are very, very concerned about what's happening there. Point number 12, we believe South Africa's leaders, government and business, should stop trying to court U.S. liberals and should instead work closely with America's conservative leaders. Number 13, South Africa should launch an effective public relations campaign around the globe. I just got to tell you, public relations is absolutely awful, and it needs to get better. Number 14, you need to form, we believe, an open, above board, overt, if you will, anti-communist alliance with Chile, South Korea, and Taiwan. These are countries which are targeted by the Soviet Union. They are targeted for overthrow by the U.S. State Department, and there is certainly strength in unity. And let me tell you something. There is no leadership in the anti-communist free world today. The United States used to be the leader of the anti-communist free world. We have ceased to do so because of our liberals and some of our powerful finance capitalists who believe it's better to finance the Soviets than your friends. We are pumping tens of billions of dollars into the Soviet Union. Do you know that the Reagan administration is pumping $22 billion of military aid, of high-tech aid, and of nuclear aid into the People's Republic of China? So I think you can say the United States is no longer the leader of the anti-communist free world. Who is the leader of the anti-communist free world? There is no leader. I'd like to nominate the Republic of South Africa to be that leader. You're a small country, but let me tell you something. You're a strong country, and you're a tough country, and you need to never underestimate some of the strengths that you have as a country. And we would love, your friends in America would love to see you become the leaders of the anti-communist free world. Let me tell you something. People behind the Iron Curtain and in free countries who are targeted by the Soviets, they're looking for leadership. They're looking for inspiration. We believe that the rollback of the Soviet Empire could start right here in South Africa. Frankly, the American liberals have talked for years about containing the Soviets, and instead of containing the Soviets, they have financed the Soviets. We think the Soviets need to be rolled back. The Soviet Empire is very fragile, and if one or two countries begin to fall, I believe you could begin to see the dominoes go in reverse. And the most fragile and the most vulnerable countries in the world that are targeted by the good guys to take out the communists are Mozambique and Angola. Okay, number 15. Your friends in America would like to see South Africa produce less welfare because if you think about it, 1.5 million white taxpayers cannot continue to carry a country with 25 or 26 million people indefinitely. And what instead you need to do is you need to open up the free market economy, and you need to basically make bloody capitalists out of your blacks in all the townships around this country. Okay? We think the South African people should boycott South African newspapers, churches, and businesses who are sympathetic to the ANC and the revolution. Okay? We would like to see a grassroots anti-communist, pro-South Africa movement, not oriented to any political party, race, or religious denomination. We think it needs to be launched. It needs to be a national organization of South Africans who love South Africa. Forget your political difference. Forget the color of a person's skin. Forget what religion you go to. South Africans who have in common that you love South Africa, that you hate communism, and that you want this country to remain free. You need to set up this kind of a grassroots movement. You already have the nucleus of probably 20, 25,000 people who are already in one way, shape, or form in this country working on kind of a grassroots basis. This needs to be expanded, because this kind of an anti-communist, well-formed electorate, well-informed electorate, I believe can give support to your government, support to your SADF in the war that is going to accelerate against South Africa. You have friends in America. You have friends elsewhere in the free world. Your friends will do everything in their power to help this country survive. We would like you to do everything in your power to help our country survive. You see, we're all on the same lifeboat, we in the Western world who are fighting communism and fighting against the forces of evil. And I think you South Africans should be concerned as to whether Central America falls to communism, or other countries in Africa, or the Philippines, or what have you. And I think you should be cooperating with the anti-communist peoples of the free world, because when you think about it, we are all in the same lifeboat. If your end of the lifeboat sinks, we will be deluged. If our end of the lifeboat sinks, you will be deluged. We're all in this fight together. I believe we're going to win it. I am tremendously optimistic about the people of South Africa and your future. One of the things that we are doing is we're videotaping this meeting tonight. We videotaped meetings all along the way on my trip. We've audiotaped them. Strongly would encourage you to get hold of these videotapes, and you can certainly contact the people who have hosted the meeting here tonight, Eileen Lovay and the True South African group, and they will give you information as to how to order the tapes. You've been given copies of the newsletters here. Please read those and distribute those. I hope that what you've heard here tonight will change your life and will change the future of South Africa. Your friends in America love you. We're encouraged. We believe South Africa will survive and prosper in the next few years. I certainly appreciate your time here tonight. Thank you so much, and God bless you. Thank you.